Forgiveness is one of the most fundamental requirements of the Christian faith. Forgiveness is a demand that Jesus Christ himself demanded and commanded of his followers. In fact, Jesus said, if you don't forgive those who trespass against you, my heavenly Father will not forgive you of your trespasses against him. If we're not willing to give forgiveness, God will withhold forgiveness from us. In the Lord's Prayer, which we are to pray daily, Jesus commanded us to ask God to request of him the power to forgive others. The Bible says to let not the sun go down upon your wrath. We are not to grow bitter when we are wronged. Jesus said, forgive those who wrong you 70 times 7. Prophetically, that's 490 times the very numerical value in which God said he would forgive his chosen people, much more the world, in the prophecy of Daniel, 70 times 7, 77. Forgiveness is a fundamental of the faith. We must forgive. We're commanded to forgive, and how hard it is sometimes to forgive when you're wrong, when you're betrayed, when you're stabbed in the back, when your good intentions and motivations are skewed and misunderstood and mistaken. And when you're taken advantage of, and when people do you wrong. And there are different levels, obviously, of wrong that can be committed against us, but it all hurts. And it takes humility to forgive. But Jesus commanded, forgive and forgive 70 times 7. How many times, the disciples said, should we forgive? And he basically gave them an infinite number, but the number specifically linked to the prophecy of Daniel, in which God is going to forgive the iniquity of humanity and the iniquity of his chosen nation. We're called to forgive. But is there a time where we could ever abstain from such? The answer, of course, is no. When people wrong us, we're not to give place to wrath. We're not to seek vengeance. But God said, get out of my way, forgive them. I will avenge. Vengeance is mine, God said, I will repay. God is the only one who can seek revenge, and that on our behalf, justly and righteously. Because we who have violated him in our former man, who knows but the things that we receive from others in the negative are seeds sown that we are reaping from, wild thorns, thistles, and briars that we sowed. And who knows that the way that we treated others has then brought this negative behavior to us, and often that's not the case in this brutal world. In this world where people are cold-hearted and they mistreat you, and where people are corrupt, where they're thieves, where they cheat, where they lie, where they slander, we are to forgive and to give place unto the wrath of God, who will avenge us in all things. Forgiveness. We meet Paul, though, in the 16th chapter of the book of Acts. In this episode of him and Silas in Philippi, we've been studying that a little bit if you watched the last video. And you know the story, Paul has been followed around by this woman, this psychic soothsayer. I've been talking about it. She pumped him up, she amped him up, she used her credibility to promote him. And Paul rebukes it and rejects it. And then the men, her pimps, as I called them, who made so much money off of her, from people coming and giving her money to get their fortune, to know what decisions they should make, etc., what stock they should invest in. They got angry because Paul cast the devil out of her. And so they said, our money's gone. And so they bring Paul and Silas, the men who are associated with the woman who said, these men are of God. They bring them to the local law enforcement in the area. And they say, these men trouble the city. And so their report of these men conflicts with the report of the woman whom they're associated with, who works for them and who they work with. And the inconsistency in their testimony blows the whole thing apart. The woman says, these men are from God. They said, these men trouble the city. Can two walk together except they be agreed? The Bible said when they brought Jesus before the leaders, the Jewish leaders, when they brought Jesus before the Roman leaders to accuse him to be crucified, that their witness disagreed with each other. You want to know, my friend, one way that the devil exposes himself is the inconsistency of witness and testimony. You've got this psychic saying, these men are of God. Well, if she's true, how can they be true if they're associated? They're both together in their false way, in their false cult, their religion, whatever, call it whatever you want. Their fortune-telling business. They say these men trouble the city. She said these men are of God. They're witnessed in degree. Nonetheless, the corrupt people in this area of the world bring down the law on Paul and Silas. And they have them beaten. And they have them beaten publicly and thrown in jail and scandalize and slander them publicly. In front of everybody they were preaching the gospel to, in front of everybody who heard, likewise, likely, this woman say these men are of God. They heard these men say these men are not of God. They trouble the city. They're liars. So who's right? Who knows how they tried to spin this and dismiss it? They probably lost their audience here, those false men who had that false fortune teller. But the public saw it. And Paul and Silas are scandalized and slandered before the public. Their reputation ruined. The words they said seemingly trashed, even though the Holy Ghost will hold it up and come back for it. But still, unethically, unlawfully, illegally, because they were Romans and Roman law protected them in this instance. But they were given no chance to speak for themselves, just hearsay, condemned by credible voices, by the louder voices, by the sponsored voices, and so put away by the law and punished by the law. And that publicly in the eyes of all those who they said Jesus Christ redeems in front of, Jesus saves, God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. I can just hear Paul now. He is Abraham's promised seed, the man with wisdom of the law and the prophets like none else had. Part of the reason why God picked him to be His chief apostle. Study to show thyself approved. The devil trained him up well. And God used him, a convert on the Damascus road. First they promote him, Paul, but that with evil motivation. And here comes their real motivation out here. Then they condemn him and crush him, and the same publicly. They promoted him publicly. They condemn him publicly. Inconsistency in their word. The people don't seem to catch it. Paul and Silas beaten and then imprisoned. And at midnight, you know the story. Paul and Silas begin to pray and sing praises to God. God sent an earthquake. And the king and judge of all the universe, the judge who overrules what corrupt judges rule, the judge of all heaven, God save and redeem every corrupt judge, but there's a higher power. There's a higher court that we can appeal to. Shall not the judge of all the earth do right? And the judge of all the earth said, touch not mine anointed. Touch not mine anointed. And do my prophets no harm. He protects his own. You are standing on holy ground. Some of you in New York City who call yourself legislators and proclaim judicial power, you might want to take your shoes off, dear friend. You've done wrong. You've done evil. And you're standing on holy ground. God have mercy on you. And God loves you. I'm not going to stone you. I know without His mercy, who am I? And I forgive you, but you need God to forgive you. And God's going to take care of that. And God's going to take care of that. And God's going to take care of that. If we trust Him and turn back to Him. But there's an earthquake in the prison cell, and God, the judge of all the earth, says, you're not putting these men away. This is wrong. My righteousness, my vengeance overrules. God gets rid of their corruption. God defends His own. And God promotes and presents the verdict. Not guilty. And He takes their slanderous trash and with an earthquake throws it away. And but for God Almighty, they would have perished that night too, but that He loved them too. And God even ends up bringing salvation to the corrupt men, some of them who put them in jail. But whenever those magistrates, the law enforcers, the judge, the chief of police, whoever who threw Paul and Silas in jail, they come and see the carnage. They see the wreckage. Like, oh Lord. We messing with something a whole lot bigger than us here. And so they gathered and had conference in private. And they said, okay, we don't want to ruin our credibility. We realize we've done wrong. Paul and Silas are good men. So they decided to secretly send messengers to Paul and Silas, who stayed in prison, who were still in prison. They could have got up and walked out, but they sat in there. God loosed their chains, the handcuffs fell off, the stocks fell off, and God broke the walls down. They could have walked out, but they sat in there, proving their innocence, even abiding by the corruption that they were held by. They had gone to the jailer's house overnight, and I believe he brought them back because they didn't leave. I think he brought them back because it was their own will. But either way, regardless of whether they were in his house or in the prison house, the jailhouse, whatever, I don't know. But they stayed where they were, we know that. Even though he took them home for a little bit and cleaned them up and medicated them. But here they find them back in the prison. And the keeper of the prison, the one who they led to the Lord, I believe, comes and brings them report and said, the magistrates, the law enforcers, have told me to let you go. Never mind everything they just did to them in front of the world. They want to come and privately, secretly hold conference and meet, realizing this thing's a lot bigger than us, realizing that God is getting involved. They don't want to tamper with this. They don't want to mess with this anymore. And they came quietly, privately to Paul and brought him word and said, okay, we're going to let you go. You can go now. You're free to go. And Paul, who is a Christian and a follower of Christ, who is submitted to and committed to the commands of his Savior. And we talked about one of the commands today, forgiveness. But Paul, in this instance, exercises something that does not seem to resemble biblical forgiveness, Christ-likeness. Verse number 37 of the 16th chapter of the book of Acts. The keeper of the prison has come and said, they want you to go away. Okay, they're going to drop the charges. You can go free. We're just not going to say anything about it. Here's what Paul says. But Paul said unto them, they have beaten us openly, publicly, uncondemned, illegally, without evidence, without wrongdoing on our part, being Romans, that's illegal, according to Roman law, and have cast us into prison. And now do they thrust us out privately? Nay, verily. But let them come themselves and fetch us out. Verse 38, and the sergeants told these words unto the magistrates, and they feared when they heard that they were Romans. They're like, oh man, it's getting worse and worse for us. Because the scandal is now shifting to exposure that these guys are playing games with law and not even applying it judicially, not even applying it practically. Or literally, or legally, I don't know the right word, properly. Verse 39, and they came and besought them, Paul and Silas, and brought them out. That means they publicly brought them out, exonerated them, and desired them to depart out of the city. They came privately, and they didn't even come themselves. They sent messengers to Paul and Silas, who these guys commanded and used the law to beat and to imprison illegally with a capital E. They illegally imprisoned them and did it in front of everybody there that they preached the gospel to, all the souls that God sent them to Philippi for. And then they realize they did wrong. They panic, so they don't show. They can't show their face. They don't want to face the faces of those who they have used the law to abuse. They just send messengers. And they say to Paul and Silas, all right, we made a mistake. You guys can go now and go away quietly. And they quietly sent messengers. Paul says, no deal. Not a chance. And he does something here that some would consider to be unforgiveness, bitterness. He stands his ground and says, you guys slandered us in front of the world. You guys beat us in front of the world. You threw us in prison in front of the world, and you were bold enough to read our verdict in front of everybody we preached to. And now you just want to quietly put us out the back door? Not a chance. Paul says, not a chance. You lied about us. You perverted our gospel. You let these two false accusing liars come in, and you accepted their word without evidence. And condemned us in front of the world. And now you want to put this thing out quietly? Not a chance. If you were good enough to slander us in front of the world, you're good enough to justify us and vindicate us in front of the world. You come get us out of here. We're sitting in here till you personally come get us out, and you get us out in front of everybody you slandered us in front of, and you tell them the truth. And so they did. They realized this ain't good. If this gets to Caesar, we're in big trouble. Mr. Augustus in the Augustus. We're in trouble. And their panic grew a little bit more and began to snowball. And they said, okay, we're going in. So they went in personally, apologized to Paul and Silas. Theirs. Clearly they were forgiven, and Paul forgave them before he did this. We'll get to that. They apologized to the men, personally escort them to the public square. And it's not written literally, but seemingly implied. They announced their innocence to everybody who they condemned them in front of illegally and falsely. And it doesn't say that they went immediately out of the city. They went back to the house of a woman named Lydia that they were staying with, their Airbnb in that town. But there are some who read this and they say, Paul's not being like Jesus. And there are some who say, when you get involved, you subject yourself to the higher power. When you get involved with governments, when you get involved with magistrates, with judges, with lawyers, be they corrupt. Some Christians say you should never act like this. I'm not exaggerating. I've run into them in my little encounter with a little bit of legal trouble over my personal association and declaration of a stand for truth that I took. Nothing illegal done on my part. But you don't have to do anything but put on the wrong political uniform, jersey, call it whatever you want, and you're committing a crime nowadays. That's all it takes. I'm a very peaceful man. I'm a man filled with the love of God, and I love people. I've never hurt a hair on anybody's head, except maybe my own, who knows? But you don't have to do much, but the crimes nowadays are, you think the wrong thing, you're a criminal. They're breaking it down to thoughts. Mr. Orwell, prophetic. But some people say you shouldn't stand against it. Subject yourself to the higher power. They use the words of Paul himself. Be subject to the higher power. Don't you dare oppose them because they're set in there by God. You keep your mouth shut like Jesus did. And Jesus did. And there's a time and place for that. But here Paul says, not today. And he, in the appropriate scenario, exercises some civil disobedience, and he holds these men accountable for what they did to him, for what they did to the name of God, for what they did to the Word of God, the Gospel of God. Not today. You're going to make this right. And some would say, this is unforgiveness. This is bitterness. But it is not any of that. This is justifiable. This is godly. This is the time and the place for we ought to obey God rather than man, as the apostle said. When is the time we do, my friends, subject ourselves to the higher power? We subject ourselves to the law of the land, but until it violates the law of God. Paul is doing that which is inspired of God. He's not acting in sin. He's not acting in bitterness or unforgiveness. He's doing that which is wholesome, that which is right, and he is contending for the faith. How? Why? Why did he do this? He forgave them. There's no unforgiveness here. He's not asking that he picks up a whip and beats them like they beat him. What he's asking for is public exoneration. And why? For his name? No. But for the souls out there who just saw him and his reputation and his gospel get slandered and ruined by lies. And Paul, not for his own sake, but for the sake of God and for the sake of souls, takes a stand here when he takes a seat in the prison house and says, you come in here, get us out, bring us out, and on the outside, you tell all of them that you were wrong. Not because I'm trying to embarrass you, not because I'm being unforgiving, but because you ruined the gospel we were preaching in their ears. In their ears. You made us out as something we were not. You took the holy life-saving of gospel of Jesus Christ and changed it and put us in chains. And even though God sent an earthquake, it was at midnight. And even though word would spread of that, Paul's not taking any chances. He that winneth souls is wise. He says, I'm going to win these souls. And you come in here, you take us out, you make it right. And he's not being rude. He's not slandering them. He's just getting them. He's not going to hurt their reputation. He's just getting them to correct the mistake they made, and they had to humble themselves to do so because they thought they were these high and mighty men. But they had messed with a higher power, greater than the power of hell, greater than the power of men, greater than the laws of men, greater than the noble of men, greater than the offices of men, greater than those esteemed of men. God is greater. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. Greater, greater is God. This is not unforgiveness. This is not unlawful behavior. He's not acting in contrast to the very words he himself wrote to subject yourself to the higher power. We must do that in the appropriate time. But when do we defy the law of the land? When do we defy those individuals who are instruments to enforce the law of the land? We do so when they defy God Almighty and his word. We ought to obey God rather than men, the scripture says, because there is a higher power, and we don't serve the law of the land. We subject to it in subjection to God. And when it contradicts the law of God, when it contradicts the rule of God and the word of God, we conflict it. And we stand against it, and we defy it, and we act in civil disobedience as Paul did here. You see, there are some individuals, my friend, when they get in offices like this, like these magistrates here, or the individuals who accuse Paul, they answer to no one, they think. They answer to nobody. And they go power tripping. And power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely, as the great man, as the great figure of history said. It corrupts. And they think they're on top. They enforce the law. They give the law. They think they're answer to nobody. But this is Paul not only informing them that you are accountable and you answer to somebody, primarily me, who you've wronged. You owe me an answer. But this is Paul also saying you owe everybody out there an answer for what you did with the answer I gave them for their life and their problems and their sin. There's a higher power, and he's not being unforgiving. He's not acting in bitterness. He's acting in godliness. And that in the waging of the war for the souls of men, when he stands his ground and fights for his reputation here, there is a higher power. And with God's help, with God's love, let me inform those of you who sit in seats of power, who exalt yourself and are lifted up in your own mind, in your own heart, in pride, and you think you answer to nobody. Friend, I love you. God loves you. But one of these days, every judge will stand before the judge of all the earth and must answer. And sometimes for the souls of men. And can you imagine the landscape of the judicial scenery where so many have been wrongfully targeted by the law? Thank God for the prison reform that was brought by Donald Trump, that is bringing many out under the corruption that has imprisoned them wrongly. Some of them targeted in certain areas of this world simply because of the reputation of that area, the crime of that area, and they themselves really did nothing wrong. Some will make it a skin color issue. I'm not going to do that because that doesn't matter. That's a human being who's having their life thrown away and wasted away at the hands of filthy, stinking corruption. And now it has even targeted a noble and just man who was a president of this land. There is a higher power. I'm not saying so arrogantly. I'm nothing. I'm nobody. I subject myself to your office unless you defy God. And then I defy you, just as Paul did. I respect you. I pray for you. But you must know there's a higher power. And not only must we demand an answer from you, not for ourselves, but for the sake of God and souls, but God one of these days is going to demand an answer for you. And you're going to have to face those as they had to face Paul, who you did wrong unto, and then you'll have to face your Maker. You took his breath, you took the life he gave you, and used it to persecute others, to oppress others, rather than using it, seek justice, walk humbly, love mercy, with arrogance and pride, using, weaponizing those good things. Again, I'm not exalting myself above anybody, I'm a nobody. I don't deserve to speak to you today. God's mercy, God's unmerited favor, the blood of Jesus Christ has made me who I am, and it can make you who you are, regardless of what you've done. But I believe we not only see the necessity for us to hold up those accountable who damage and slander the gospel and the ministers of God here and those called in the name of God. We must hold them accountable. As Paul did, it's not unforgiveness. It's part of the process of keeping things balanced, because right now, friend, they don't answer to anybody. That's why they're doing what they're doing. We don't answer to anybody. You answer to us, friend. You answer to us. And you answer to God. There's a higher power. And when you defy Him, in appeal to heaven, our forefathers said, corruption reigned and oppressed, and they sought a land. This land is your land. This land is my land. They said, God of heaven, we commit it unto thee, and to thee it shall be. There's a higher power. And at the name of Jesus Christ, every knee will bow, every tongue confess, including me. You can stand on your feet today. You may not even be able to stand on your feet, but you'll be able to in that day. And you'll use that muscle and that strength to get on your knees. That means both. Every knee shall bow, even if you lost some of your physical extremities. You'll have them that day, and you'll use them to bow before Jesus Christ. There's a higher power. There's a higher power in every power of earth. Not only must the child of God and the citizen of this planet subject themselves to just law that is not in defiance of God. Civil disobedience must be the case if the law of the land defies the law of God. Elsewise, you're disobeying God and trying to obey men, and you're committing a greater sin than you would be in subjecting yourself to the law of men in an effort to please the Word of God. If it defies the Word of God, you better defy it, or you're sinning against God and disobeying Him. Civil disobedience is a necessity when the law of the land gets out of control and defies the law of God. Otherwise, you're disobeying God. Lecrae said, I'm a rebel. I don't like too many of his songs, but I like that one. I'm in rebellion. I'm in rebellion. Everybody's afraid to go against the crowd. Let's go against the crowd and rebel in Jesus' name. And Paul says, I'm rebelling here. You answer to me. You answer to God, and you answer to these people out here that you lied to about me. He doesn't do it for himself. He doesn't do it for his own reputation other than the reputation he has to preach the gospel, because that is very, very precious. And he says, you go tell them that you were wrong, that you did wrong, that this is wrong. The answer to him implied the answer to the people, if nothing else than the display of them bringing Paul and Silas out in that public apologetic posture, releasing them. And their wounds have been ministered to by the buried prisoner himself, the keeper of the prison himself. When they become power hungry and reckless, and when they begin to defy God, we hold them accountable. That's not unbiblical. That's not unscriptural. No, we love you, but it's we the people, not you the whoever. And who gave judges this much power? When did that happen? They just start swinging at people with their gavel. And we're supposed to do everything they say? I'm sorry, we love you, but you answer to us, and you answer to God, and you answer to the public for what you're doing for whatever cause. And thank God for the just, righteous judges that are out there. But I have little hope for the judicial system of the United States. It's beginning to mirror that of the Soviet Union or the communist countries of this world, where the decision is not made by any other than a compromised judge and jury who have been given the verdict before they were even given or presented with any fact or evidence or due process to those who are to be granted defense. Just throw them in jail. Just throw the law at them. You answer to Paul. You answered all. And it's not unforgiveness. It's not unbiblical behavior. You violate the gospel. You pervert the gospel. You must give account. And you would rather give account to Paul than you would to God. Ask God to forgive you. Please ask Him to forgive you. I don't want you to be judged by God. I've seen him. The scariest moment of my existence. The most frightening sight in the middle of the night. I wanted to die, but I couldn't die because I'd been removed from my body. One of these days, you're going to be removed from your body and you will stand before the judge of all the earth, and not in your judicial robes with no gavel in your hand, but your fate will be in his hands. And will your fate be in the scars of his hands or in the hands that wrote on stone the writing of his hand? That wrote on stone and said, "Thou shalt not." What will your end be? Where's the integrity? Where's the sacredness of a law that was inspired by the law of God? Where is truth? We've seen it all. It's been conditional in it all. It's still conditional. Even the warning of the coming theft in the second round was conditional. That's why we were proactive. That's why we tried to preach and prophesy and pray. But the hearts of men did not turn, so that which was, has been, and it will be if we do not turn back to God. If we don't start holding these reckless individuals accountable, these criminals clothed in robes of law enforcers and in the clothing of law enforcement. It's not the jersey, it's who wears the jersey. The just shall live by faith, put on Christ. It's not wrong. We're not being carnal. It's for the gospel. I'm not being carnal. It's for the gospel. Jesus Christ could come tonight. My eyes are on eternity. I'm laying up treasure in heaven. I'm not planning to live in this world. My involvement in anything political is for the gospel of Jesus Christ, for the preaching of the word. That's why Paul did what he did. It's not for the things of this world. It is that what you're doing is preventing me from being out there preaching, and that you have perverted my preaching out there. Therefore, I must demand that you, by the mercy of God, come out and correct it openly and publicly. Otherwise, souls will suffer. So it's not for the things of this world. We don't get involved in politics or anything of this world for the things of this world. It's for the gospel. Paul did it for the gospel. We take our stand for souls. We take our stand for the kingdom with our eyes on his coming, with our eyes for eternity. And we do what we do in civil matters for eternity. We're not staying here. I'm not motivated by politics. I have no political affiliation with any party. I've said it before, I'm in the kingdom party. And anything I do in matters of civility has to do with eternity. And such it must be for us all. It's all about Jesus. It's all about him. God will avenge his own. God will protect his own. And many times God will use his own to do so. Stand up. Stand up for Jesus. You soldiers of the cross, lift high the bloodstained banner. This is not a time, as Marcus Rogers says, for gummy bear Christians, for cowards. This is a time for the men and women of God who were created and placed in this world for such a time as this to stand up and to say, we're not going anywhere. You come here and you make it right. You lied. You cheated. We're not interested in defaming you or doing to you what you've done to us. We're forgiving you. Just make it right in regards to the gospel. That's what we want. And we're not leaving here till you do it. There's nothing unbiblical or unchristian about that. That is good, and that we must do. And the reason why evil progresses as it does is because the saints of God have been so idle and quiet and silent. And many of you wonder, why did God put me on earth for this time? You seek the things of this world. You've got your idea, the home you want, the job you want, the family you want, the children you want. You've got it all picked out. And you see all the trouble in this world. It's not looking good for your plans. But it takes mans like me and others to stand up so you can see your plans. Otherwise, you never will see them. But the reason why you're put on this world in this troubled time was for such a time as this. That's why God gave you the strength and the breath and the life so that you could lift up your voice for the gospel of Jesus Christ. It's not a time to be ashamed. It's not a time to be weak. It's a time to be on fire for God. It's not a time to be bribed. We must not be for sale. It's not a time to be subject to the flattery of the damsel who will compliment and endorse, perhaps even seeking compromise. It is a time to stand up for Jesus Christ, stand up for the gospel, and stand against the evil in love to those who are used by evil, as we seek even their salvation. Do thyself no harm. We're all here. Jesus Christ loves you. He died for you. If you're on corruption, if you're performing corruption, He has come with His goodness to save you and forgive you, and He loves you. I don't hate you. Nobody hates you. What you're doing is wrong, and you know it, and there's a way out. You don't have to go to hell. You don't have to pay for your crimes. You don't have to suffer the vengeance of God that will avenge those who you're wronging. No amount of money you have received to do so is going to be worth it. When God's justice catches up with you, you'll reap what you've sown. You will reap what you've sown. But you don't have to, because Jesus Christ bled and died on the cross of Calvary to take your sins away. He bled and died for you. The goodness of God is extended to you, pedophile, corruption, thief, liar, adulterer, homosexual, transgender. Jesus loves you. Jesus loves you. Jesus died for you. And Jesus Christ will save and redeem you if you just extend your hand to Him and receive Him by faith. Cry out to Jesus. There is hope for the helpless, rest for the weary, love for the broken heart. God loves you. God died for you, and God will redeem and justify you if you just look to Him by faith. There is hope. There is help. You don't have to go to hell. You don't have to pay for your crimes. You can be forgiven. You'll be forgiven by the children of God. We'll not hold a grudge. We're not looking to destroy your life like you have many of ours, potentially. We're looking to lead you to salvation just as we were led to salvation. We who potentially once persecuted the church will look even for the redemption of those who persecute us, but we know it's wrong. Therefore, we will stand by the help of God. Stand up, Christian. Kneel down, sinner. There is a higher power. Don't subject yourself to the high powers of earth in fear. There's a higher power. There's a much higher power. Those powers of earth who we esteem to be high defy the highest power. You obey and you follow the highest power. We ought to obey God rather than men. It doesn't matter. Men rule. God overrules. They can buy the referees. God is the judge of all the earth. God's the commissioner. God is king. There is a higher power, my friend. Submit to it now. Subject to it now. Or be subjected to it then against your will. It's all on you. There's a higher power. High powers need to understand there's a higher power. We don't subject to high power unless it is in unison with the highest power. We are strangers and pilgrims on earth, the children of God. We're not so much living by the law of the land as we are living by the law of God. And if the law of the land defies Him, we defy it. And it has been recently, unfortunately. And violence is a last resort, but that it be defensive. But many times offensive is defensive, as I explained before. We don't seek those things. We seek peace and we seek love, hope, by faith. Jesus loves you. Come to Him today. There's a higher power. And one of these days, we're all going to bow before it. Higher power, exalted high above the heavens, high above all thrones and dominions and powers. Jesus Christ, King of kings, Lord of lords. He is the higher power. Yeah, higher.